get the band back together, get the symphony, get the children's choir, get the high school marching band, and the dancers. Don't forget the dancers. We're gonna play a new song, all of us, everyone. This will be God's song. It's part of Him, and it's been given to us. And we will sing it from the tallest buildings. It will be the greatest song of all. We will sing it when we are low. We will sing it when we are on a mountain. It is a song of the universe, from its beginning to the present moment, now, this moment. And it will go on forever because God goes on forever. This is God's song. God the Creator, God the Good, God the Just, God who brushes His opposers off like dust from His shoulders, God the Mighty and God the Merciful. People will sing this song. People will dance to this song. No critics allowed. They will be stopped dead in their tracks. Their words will be turned against them because today, we will sing. Today the baby is born. Today the angels break forth. Today darkness cowers in the corner. Today wrongs are righted, prophecies are fulfilled, wounds are healed, the hungry stomachs are filled. Today we all get adopted. Today Jesus comes to earth. Yes, Jesus, the Messiah. And this is the song we sing. This song will heal the world. This song is the song of our Savior. He is born. Hallelujah. Jesus Christ is born.
Welcome everyone to our Christmas Eve service. We're so glad to have you joining us tonight online. And we're going to celebrate some songs of the season as we lift up our Savior today. We love you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Let's sing this old Christmas hymn together. Joy to the world. Joy to the world, the Lord is come. Let earth receive her King. Let every heart prepare Him room. And heaven and nature sing.
Jesus, Emmanuel,
on, sing it with me. It's all about Jesus tonight. Jesus, Emmanuel. Oh, come let us adore him. Hallelujah. Jesus, we adore you tonight. And we love you and we celebrate you in this place. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
I ask thee to stay close by.
This is the night we celebrate Jesus' birth. What a holy night.
Oh, holy night. The stars are bright, they shine. It is the night of our dear Savior's birth. Sin and error pining till he appeared and the soul felt its worth. A thrill of hope, a weary world rejoices for yonder. A new and glorious morn fall on your knees. Oh, hear the angel voices. Oh, night divine. When Christ was born, oh, night divine, oh, night divine. Thank you.
God bless you in this Christmas season.
All right. How's everybody doing today?
Good.
Good? Good. Are we excited for Christmas?
Yes.
What did we ask for Christmas? What do we want?
Ellie wants a dog.
You want a dog? I feel like you said dog last year, too.
She does. She always wants a dog.
You want diapers? I think I heard you wrong.
No, I want skateboard.
Oh, yeah, you want a skateboard.
Yeah.
I remember you telling me about that.
Bunny.
You want a real bunny?
And a moving bunny.
And a moving bunny. Okay. Emma, are we going to go with another animal here? Do we want to throw out a horse?
No.
No, you don't want a horse. Okay, what would you like?
Too big in the house.
Okay.
Can't go in the house.
What is on your Christmas list?
Unicorn.
A unicorn.
Stuffed animal one.
Oh, a stuffed animal. Okay, I was going to say, you said no horses, but unicorn.
No, not a real unicorn.
All right. Well, as is tradition, we are going to start by reading the Christmas story. A story I'm sure you have all heard before, but it's really good that we read it again every year. Because it's an exciting story, isn't it? Yes, yes it is. All right, so here we go. We are going to start. Now, the Christmas story started long before this point, back before God even created the world. But in the Bible, it tells us and it gives us all that history. But we're going to pick it up right here, okay, with Mary. God's ways and timing are always perfect. God picked just the right time for Jesus to come to earth. And he picked just the right parents for him. A young girl named Mary was alone one day when an angel appeared right in front of her. She couldn't believe her eyes. "Don't be afraid, Mary," said the gentle voice of God's angel Gabriel. "God is pleased with you. Soon you will have a baby boy. His name will be Jesus. Nothing is impossible for God." Mary trusted her Lord. "I will do whatever God wants," she told Gabriel. Mary's fiancé, Joseph, found out she was going to have a baby before they were married. Joseph was worried. An angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream. "Joseph, son of David," the angel said, "don't be afraid to take Mary as your wife. The baby is from the Holy Spirit. Name him what? What is his name?
Jesus.
Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins." When Joseph woke up, he obeyed God and did just what the angel commanded. Now, there's also another baby in the story. Mary's cousin, Elizabeth, was very old when an angel told her husband, Zechariah, that they would have a son and they were to name him John. John would tell people why they needed a savior and that the one to save them was Jesus. When Elizabeth had her baby, everyone celebrated with her and Zechariah. Then Zechariah said, "You, my little son, will be called the prophet of the Most High because you will prepare the way for the Lord. You will tell his people how to find salvation through forgiveness of their sins." Just before Mary was about to have her baby, Joseph had to travel to his hometown, Bethlehem, to pay taxes. Bethlehem was so full of people that there were no rooms left for them. A kind innkeeper said they could stay where he kept his animals. That night, Mary had her baby. God's son was born in a stable. In the stillness of the night, he came. God's gift of Christmas. The one who would save the world. His mother wrapped him in cloths and lovingly placed him in a manger. And there he took a nap.
That doesn't say the story.
He probably slept. Babies sleep a lot. In nearby fields, shepherds were watching over their flocks. Suddenly, an angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord was shining around them. "Do not be afraid," the angel said. "I bring good news that will be great joy for all people. Today in Bethlehem, the city of David, the Savior has been born. He is the Messiah, Christ the Lord." Suddenly, a great crowd of angels lit up the sky, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace and goodwill toward men." The shepherds ran quickly to find the baby Jesus. Then they told everyone about what they had seen and heard. Wise men from the east followed a bright shining star. They visited King Herod and asked, "Where is the young child, the king of the Jews? We saw his star and we have come to worship him." King Herod was not happy. Let me see your not happy faces. Hopefully all we see is happy faces on Christmas morning.
Yeah.
Yeah. "When you find him, tell me so that I can worship him too." But he lied. The star led the wise men straight to Jesus, and they were filled with great joy. "We have come to worship your son," they told Mary. They presented their treasure chests of gifts, gold, frankincense, and myrrh, and bowed down to worship him. God warned the wise men in a dream not to return to Herod, so they found a different route and set out on their journey home. The angel of the Lord also appeared to Joseph in a dream and said, "You must escape to Egypt." Why?
Because King Herod was trying to kill Jesus.
Because King Herod was going to try to kill Jesus. Yes. And the angel said, "You must stay until I tell you to return." Joseph obeyed God immediately. That night he took his little family and fled to Egypt for safety. After a while, the angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph again and said, "Get up. You can safely go back to Israel." Joseph moved his family to a town called Nazareth in Galilee. Jesus grew up strong and wise. He taught people about God and his kingdom. Jesus loved people more than anyone who has ever lived on the earth. He died so that all the bad things we do can be forgiven and we can live with him forever. This Christmas, remember, God loves you so much that he sent his son Jesus to the world so he could spend forever with you. Nothing is impossible for God. His miracles are everywhere. God always keeps his promises. He loves you more than you know. God's glorious gift of Christmas is for you. And God's Christmas gift is to you as well. And so this season, as we celebrate with our family, I just encourage you to make reading the Christmas story a part of your tradition to just help us focus on him and how much he has loved us. So we wish you a Merry Christmas, and let's all say it together. Merry Christmas.
Merry
Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
Love you all.
Thank you. Christmas, Rock Church family. So good to be celebrating this day with you. And in some ways, this year has gone so slow, but also so very fast. And as we recount the conclusion of the Advent journey today, I want to remind you of what has brought us to this place. Luke chapter 2 records the story. Joseph and Mary are headed to Bethlehem due to the call for a census, and then we find them in a place where it says that it came time for Mary to give birth. And because there was no place for them to find shelter, they find themselves in a stable. And Jesus is born, he's wrapped in swaddling clothes, and he is placed in the manger. And as we recount that story, and as we reflect upon all that this day means, I want to make one thing clear. This is a day of celebration. The Christmas journey is one that reminds us of things that are essential to our faith, a work that Christ does within us. And on the first Sunday of Advent, we recounted the theme of hope, and we lit that first candle. That reminder of the hope that is found in Christ is something that calls us to recount the fact that God has kept his promises. And if he has kept that promise, he will keep every other promise that he has made for us. The scriptures are clear. Our Lord is not a man that he would lie, but yet he is faithful and he is true. And this season is one that is filled with hope, not only because the Lord has kept his promise to us, but it is one that gives us hope for the future. Because we know that our Savior was not only born in a stable, but we know that he is coming again one day soon as King to rule and to reign and to fix this broken world that we live in. And on the second Sunday, we were reminded of peace. Peace was one of the great announcements that was associated with the birth of Christ. And it is a peace that is not found within us, but rather it is a peace that comes upon us. As we enter into relationship with the Lord, we are put in right standing before God. And we have relationship with the one that we were separated from. And that peace is a relational peace that we have with our Savior. But flowing out from that is a peace that comes as a part of our life experience, because circumstances are no longer in control, but God is. And because of that, we not only experience peace within, but we can experience peace with other people. So may that be a part of our holiday experience as we gather together and as we catch up with friends and loved ones. May we be an instrument of God's peace, because we have peace with him, peace within, and can consequently have peace with others. The Advent journey is one where we're reminded of the joy that was associated with the birth of Christ. Luke chapter 2 tells us that that joy will be for all of mankind, and that truly is good news. That in life we can experience a joy that comes from the Lord, that is untouched by the things of this world. And at the source of that joy is an understanding of how the Lord works redemptively within us. The Bible tells us that the Lord is the one who takes the ashes of our lives and he makes something beautiful. The scriptures tell us that we may find ourselves weeping throughout the day, but that joy comes in the morning. The scriptures tell us that we may experience distress, but the Lord is able to turn our distress into rejoicing. So what does that mean for us as a people who are living life in a world that is very challenging and complicated? Well, it reminds us that we can have joy and confidence in this. When we stumble, or when we make mistake, the Lord is able to redeem it, and He has the power to do so when we turn to Him. And the fourth week of Advent reminds us of the love of God. The scriptures say that God so loved the world that He gave His Son. The Lord's love for us was expressed in this way, that as God looked down from heaven and saw our plight, He did not leave us in that place, but rather as an expression of His love, He restored and made a way for us to know Him and to find new life in Him. And that love is ultimately expressed in the cross, the death of our Savior, and His resurrection on the third day unto victory. And because of that, salvation is a free gift to all who will put their faith in the Lord Jesus. So we're reminded of the fact that the Lord loves us, He receives us just as we are, and He has provided all that we need to experience new life in Him. But the significance of this Advent journey is this. It is just that. It is a journey that builds from one week to the next, reminding us of those things that are vital to our faith, those gifts that God has given us as His children. And because of that, a part of Advent must be us making room for Him. And as we contemplate all that He has done, we celebrate that Christ has come, the Messiah has been born, and we make room for Him. And I'd like for all of us to now just take a moment to prepare room for Him and to have a time of reflection where together, where we are quieting ourselves and humbling our hearts, as we become mindful of maybe one area within our lives where we need His hope, His peace, His joy, and His love to be at work again. So I invite you all to do that right now where you are. Would you turn that place into an altar as you bow your heads and humble your hearts and have that personal, quiet conversation with the Lord, as you recall the way that you would ask Him to work in your life again. And now today, as Christmas Eve brings us to the conclusion of the Advent journey, we light the Christ candle. This candle represents our Lord, and it calls us to recount the fact that Jesus is the light of the world. In fact, Jesus said that of Himself in the Gospel of John. He said, "I am the light of the world. He who follows Me shall not walk in darkness, but have the light of life." What an encouraging verse that is. When we put our faith and our hope and our trust in Jesus, we no longer walk in darkness, but rather we walk in light of Him. And as we follow Him, He leads us, and He leads us down a path of righteousness, the Bible says. Now, the context of when Christ spoke those words has always been interesting to me, and it has always struck me significantly, because He spoke those words at a moment when a woman made a life-altering decision. And that decision took her in the wrong way. And as she looked back upon that decision, she probably saw it as tragic and life-altering, a mistake that she wished she could take back. And as she laid at the feet of Jesus, and as she was being accused, and as Jesus ministered to her in a redemptive way, He stated those words, "I am the light of the world." That when we know him and we follow him, we no longer walk in darkness, but we have the light of life. Jesus is the life giver. He is the one who gives us fullness of life, abundant life, life lacking in nothing, and eternal life in the life to come. And today, as we evaluate our own state, the journey that we have been on this year, we all probably look back with things that we wish we could do over, mistakes that we wish we would not have made, words that we wished we could have taken back, or words that we wish we would have spoken. Let the lighting of the Christ candle remind you today that even when we make mistakes, Christ is able to lift us up out of that place. And you know, that is good news for all of us. That truth is at the heart of the gospel. It is a part of what draws us to him in the moment of conversion, and it is what causes us to cling to him as we live our lives for him. And today, on this Christmas Eve, whether you are at home or you are in person at the church in service, I want you to be reminded today that Jesus is the light of the world. And because of that, and because we have relationship with him, God is for us. And today is a day of celebration. The birth of Christ reminds us that through him, we receive new life, new purpose, and new direction. And as we conclude this Advent journey, and as we begin to embark on a new journey in the year 2021, let's do so, living in the light of his love, of his joy, of his peace, and of his hope. So as we conclude our time in prayer again, would you join me in placing your life in the hands of the Lord? Christmas is a time for us to remember that Christ was born and what he has accomplished, and to establish him as Lord over our lives again. So as you pray with me, would you place your life in his hands as we look forward to the year 2021. May God bless you. Have a Merry Christmas. May the Lord watch over you and keep you. We love you, and we look forward to worshiping again together soon. God bless.
As we close out this evening and this Christmas of 2020, let us go to the Lord in prayer. Father, I thank you for the gift of Jesus. I pray that each of us might know the hope you have given us through the power of the Holy Spirit. I pray that your peace that passes understanding not only calm our hearts, but wash over everyone we come in contact with this Christmas. I thank you for the joy that fills our hearts, not just for a season, but for the year round. And may our hearts and spirits be filled to overflowing with the love you have showered upon us. Help us to be a reflection of the hope, peace, joy, and love we have received from you in the coming year. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. God bless you. Have a blessed Christmas day.